nessuno può cadere per il fratello. E tutte le cose che tu hai attaccato insieme a te. E poi con se ti ha attaccato a una posto che si dovrà far grato.
Today we're talking about a Guardian of the Galaxy, a female one, one that has entirely nothing to do with that movie. It's Rosalina. We're talking about Rosalina from Super Mario Galaxy. But yeah, that movie was great, right? I love the part where Star-Lord was like, I'm Star-Lord, and he's all like, pew 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 pew. Then Groot was totally like, I am Groot. Oh, we're on. Hello, internets! Welcome to Game Theory, the show that really can't wait for Guardians of the Galaxy 2. Seriously, I have not had that much fun at a movie in a long time. Oh, so good. Sorry, I gotta stay focused. Anyway, let's talk about Rosalina. She's a galaxy-hopping princess with a hairstyle stolen straight from Captain Planet's Dr. Blight. And from her humble beginnings in Super Mario Galaxy, she's starting to appear in everything. 3 main series titles, 4 Mario Karts, a party, a round at the Links, and pretty soon the newest Smash. Really? Rosalina and like 15 Fire Emblem characters, and Ness still hasn't been confirmed for the game? Get your priorities straight, Nintendo. But outside of she owns a space station and she looks smoking hot in a biker outfit, what do we really know about this monotone maiden? Nothing! She's an interstellar enigma. Or is she? Who is Rosalina? Have there been clues hidden in plain sight as to what her true identity is? Today we're out to solve this maiden's mystery, and what we find throws everything you thought you knew about the Mario universe out the window. Well, except for the fact that he's a sociopath, which is still 100% legit. It seems to me the best place to start is with the bedtime story Rosalina reads throughout Super Mario Galaxy. The story recounts the tale of a sad little girl on a quest to find one Luma's missing mother. Prepare to be shocked, that story is actually about Rosalina herself. What? An earth-shattering revelation, I know. But seriously, where it gets interesting is in Chapter 4, when the story mentions Rosalina's mother. Via the book's illustrations, we get 2 glimpses of her. First, from the back, and then again, the bottom half of her face. Do those hair flips, that mouth shape, the gold crown, and those rounded blue earrings look familiar? Because they should. Peach is Rosalina's mother. Cue the dramatic music. Not quite as dramatic as I envisioned, but okay. No, wait, I can read your mind. But the hair is longer and the dress is blue. That's what you're thinking, right? Right, be honest. Man, I'm like the geeky version of David Blaine. But I agree, these similarities are very superficial and far from 100% confirmation. That's why it's also worth mentioning the silhouette of the castle that appears in Chapter 7 of the book, when the little girl in the story looks at her former home through her father's old telescope. Notice the 3 prominent spires with the 1 big one in the middle? Seems an awful lot like typical depictions of Peach's castle, no? Since it's in shadow, though, I suppose it could be just any old 3-spired castle with 1 very tall one in the center. I mean, I hear those are very popular in the Mushroom Kingdom after all. Hashtag obvious sarcasm is obvious. But if we're going to prove something as huge as Rosalina being the daughter of the First Lady of Gaming, we need something more than hints. We need something more definitive. We need something scientific. Genes! Ronnie, come on, let's try it again. Genes! Genetics, DNA, deoxyribonucleic acid. Come on, dude, you're ruining my flow. If Peach and Rosalina are truly related, they should be sharing some physical features, right? And yeah, I mean, obviously they look alike, but we're the game theorists. We can do one better. We can use genetics to show that there's a high statistical probability that the 2 are related. So let's start with one of Rosalina's most identifiable traits. Her earlobes. Bet you didn't see that one coming. Whether or not your earlobes hang low and wobble to and fro, or are attached to your head, is dictated by a simple dominant-recessive gene relationship. You probably did this stuff in school, right? 7th grade bio-sci, anyone? But to recap, you get 1 set of genes, or alleles, from your father and 1 set from your mother. The combination dictates what trait you show. That's called your phenotype. Phenotype for physical. It's what people see. So for earlobes, dangling earlobes are dominant, and attached earlobes are recessive. Let's demonstrate that with a big D and a little d. So as an example, let's say that your father and mother both have one big D allele and one small d allele. By creating a chart called a Punnett square that shows all the possible gene combinations the child could have, where he gets one gene from each parent, you see that the child is most likely to have dangling earlobes, because three out of the four scenarios contain a big D. The big D is dominant or stronger and covers up the little d. But if you have two little d alleles, one from mom and one from dad, your lobes will be attached, making it the rarer trait. Which is funny because Rosalina, believe it or not, has attached earlobes. Check it out! And that means both her parents would need to possess the small d allele. But how could we possibly figure out the genetic code of fictional video game characters? I'm glad you asked that. Well, you start by looking at the phenotype. What do Peach's ears look like? Trick is, Peach's ears are normally covered by her ungodly large blue earrings. But Nintendo has been kind enough to show us Peach in her developmental stages, Baby Peach. Baby Peach doesn't have her ears pierced, and thus we can see that she too has attached earlobes. In other words, she possesses two small d alleles, greatly increasing the likelihood that her child would also have attached lobes. And that's not all. Look at Mario, who presumably would be the father. Attached earlobes again, which means that the child of Peach and Mario would have a 100% chance of also having attached earlobes. Rosalina. And that's not all. What about eye and hair color? Now, these things work a little bit differently. Both are polygenic, or controlled by multiple genes. Let's focus on eye color. Eye color happens to be controlled by at least two separate genes. The first one, OCA2, comes in two forms, brown and blue. The second one, called also comes in two forms, but this time it's green and blue. Now, the way this works is in a tiered system, with blue alleles being recessive, green being dominant over blue, and brown trumping them all. Here's a chart mapping out all the possible combinations, and as you can see, blue eyes are super rare because there are so many other genes that overpower those small Bs. So for Rosalina to have those piercing blue eyes of hers, her parents would also need to- Well, somebody call Staples, because that was easy. The fact that both Peach and Mario also have blue eyes means that their child would have a very high likelihood of also having bright blue eyes, just like you see in Rosalina. Hair color works in a lot the same way. It's also polygenic. Without getting too detailed, the fact that Peach has blonde hair greatly increases the likelihood her child would also have blonde hair. So to summarize, with genetics, we're talking about statistical odds. And in this case, were Peach and Mario to have a baby, there's a very high likelihood that it would have the same phenotypes that you see in Rosalina. The last huge piece of genetic evidence, though, comes from Rosalina's handedness. Watch all the gameplay footage of her, and you see that she's left-handed. Notice how she prefers to keep her wand in her left hand? In an interesting twist, promotional art for her shows her holding it in her right hand, but I would assume that this is actually the product of the world's right-handed bias. But that's a can of worms for an entirely different day. For now, let's focus on the genetics. Handedness is weird because it's not like the previous genetic examples. Researchers have no clear predictors that they've been able to figure out. What scientists do know is that consistently, 10% of the world's population is left-handed, and that left-handedness tends to run in families, with the mother's preference being an important factor. On average, the chances of two right-handed parents having a left-handed child are around 10%. Having a right-handed mother and left-handed father keeps that percentage about the same. But having a left-handed mother and right-handed father makes the probability double. Now, looking across games, particularly the sports games, Mario Super Sluggers, Mario Tennis, Mario Golf, Nintendo's main man is clearly right-handed, no question there. But Peach is actually ambidextrous, good with both her right and left hands, playing baseball and tennis favoring the right, but golfing favoring the left. People born with a left-hand bias at birth are statistically more likely to show ambidextrous qualities later in life. So the likelihood of a couple like her and Mario having a left-handed child like Rosalina is actually greater than most other couples. The only thing that would increase those odds would have both parents be lefties, which increases the probability to 35%. So similar to how we approach TF2's Pyro, not only does Peach match the mother's depiction in the storybook, but statistically speaking, Peach's hypothetical daughter would have a much higher than normal chance of sharing a lot of the same qualities as Rosalina. But there's one final piece to this puzzle. Let's revisit Chapter 7 of Rosalina's bedtime story. We've already talked about the illustrations, but let's talk about the clues buried in the actual text. Quote, "She twisted the knob of the telescope, and the blue dot grew until she could make out a grassy hill dotted with flowers. It seemed very familiar to her. Zooming even closer, a terrace on the hill came into view. She remembered rubbing the sleep out of her eyes as she followed her father up that hill to look at the stars." So we know that Rosalina's home, that castle we saw in silhouette, isn't far from a good stargazing hill dotted with flowers. Galaxy's opening scene has Mario running to the top of a hill that overlooks Peach's castle, meaning it's close enough to walk to, and has a beautiful view of the stars. It also happens to be lined with flowers, just like the hill described in the storybook. And not only does it have flowers, but look at the color of the flowers in the illustration. Purple, white, and yellow. Now look at the flowers on Mario's hill at the beginning of the game. Purple, white, and yellow. Now we're getting somewhere. And there's more. Here's an excerpt from when Rosalina's story takes a dark turn. Quote, "She remembered having picnics with her mother on that hill on bright and windy days, and the girl burst into tears. I want to go home. I want to go back to my house by the hill. I want to see my mother," the girl was shouting now, her face wet with tears. "But I know she's not there. I knew all along that she wasn't out there in the sky because she's sleeping under the tree on the hill." The girl's cries echoed through the stars, and a hush fell over the area. Like a punch to the gut, the story reveals that the girl's mother has been dead and buried the whole time. In a game like Mario, where dying in pits of lava or getting sucked into black holes is pretty much par for the course, knowing that there's a character that has died and is buried is just unsettling. It's a bit eerie. But this passage also provides us another clue as to the geography of this hill. There's a single tree on top of it. Find that tree on top of that stargazing hill that's right down the road from Peach's castle and with the yellow, purple, and white flowers, and you've got yourself a slam dunk. So, I played through the beginning of the game again looking to find that tree and didn't. Theory busted. Or was it? I remember that the end of the game features one final, grand, sweeping shot of the landscape around Peach's castle. And would you believe it? At the top of that hill, the hill that Mario just so happens to start the game at, the hill that matches all the qualities we've been looking for so far, what's at the top of that hill? A single tree. Whew, did you feel that? I just got a chill down my spine. All the signs are there. Peach's hair, earrings, mouth, and crown in the illustrations. The genetics contributing to Rosalina's attached earlobes, blue eyes, blonde hair, and left-handedness. And the geography of the stargazing hill with white, yellow, and purple flowers with a single tree on top that Rosalina's mother is buried under. Wait, if Peach is Rosalina's mother, then that would mean Peach should be buried under that tree. How is that possible? Clearly I've overlooked something. Or I'm just running out of time and have to save it for part two. I promise you not. So it looks like someone finally got a piece of that cake, if you know what I'm saying. Wink, wink, nudge, nudge. Plow, chicka, plow, plow.
Let's get it on
from downtown!
But how can Peach be here and here? All shall be revealed today! Hello, Internet! Welcome to Game Theory, the show that is finally concluding a two-part series! Now, if only I would do that Watch Underscore Dogs episode. Anyway, last time we used a little bit of Mario Galaxy lore and a heapin' helpin' of genetics to conclude that Rosalina has an unusually high probability of being Peach's daughter. But there were a few sticking points to that theory, in particular that Rosalina's mother is dead. And Peach doesn't seem to be. There are other problems too, like the relative lack of an age difference between Peach and Rosalina, but this episode will answer all those concerns and more, not only solving the mystery of Rosalina's parentage and the eternal question of Mario Jumpman Mario's multiple lives, but also completely overturning everything you thought you knew about Miyamoto's beloved franchise. If you thought Mario being a sociopath was earth-shattering, just wait till you see the end of this one. So let's start with the elephant in the room, Peach being dead. As we concluded last episode, Rosalina's mother is buried under a tree on her favorite stargazing hill. How can that possibly happen when, breathing, kidnapped by Bowser, calling for help, promise of future cake. Yep, Peach seems to be at least somewhat alive in Super Mario Galaxy. Well, that's actually the whole premise of the game. The game's ending. Do I need a spoiler alert for a Mario game ending? Like, they're always one step above congratulations. So here, spoiler alert for practically every Mario game ever. Peach gets saved and Bowser falls into lava. Say that's probably about like 87% of the games. Clearly we are not playing these games for the epic conclusion, friends. But Galaxy is part of the 13%, sporting one of the most bizarrely cryptic endings to happen since Enslaved on the Xbox. Bowser, Mario, and Peach all get sucked into a cataclysmic black hole, and everything gets destroyed. Look at the way it decimates Bowser's ship. A bunch of baby stars then sacrifice themselves, creating something similar to the Big Bang, which brings to life a whole new galaxy. Rosalina then talks to Mario about the cycle of rebirth, how stardust from dying stars eventually reforms into a new star, and the cycle continues, but with small changes each time. It's like an astronomical version of Groundhog's Day. No two go-arounds are exactly the same. She then tells Mario that he'll see. Mario wakes up and is back in the Mushroom Kingdom, but things are a bit different. You have all the intergalactic characters from the game living on the same planet now. Mario welcomes the new galaxy, pan out, spot Peach's burial tree on the hill, roll credits. So, what happened exactly? That black hole seemed to destroy everything, everyone is now on the same planet, and Rosalina's closing speech is vague at best. Well, her cryptic dialogue actually explains it all. Mario, Peach, Bowser, and all the rest have just been reborn into a new galaxy cycle. At the beginning of the game, we were playing in a galaxy that had all the characters separated out onto different planets. But in this new, remixed version of the galaxy that was just created by the black hole and baby Lumas, everyone exists on the same planet. The cycle has been restarted, but with the small difference of everyone sharing a planet. You see? Let me put it a different way. True loyal theorists watching this show will remember long, long ago when I covered the Zelda timeline. There, you had a parallel series of multiverses, each with a small tweak. Link survives in this timeline, dies in this one, and never exists in the third. It would seem Mario's world believes in something similar. Think about it like hitting the reset button on your old NES. Is that a reference that anyone even gets at this point? Anyway, the old NES had a reset button. Just go with me here. So you want to fire up a game of Super Mario Brothers on your NES. You hit the power button, the screen flickers, you have to eject cartridge, blow in it, reinsert it, push it down, and you hit the power button again, and there you go, the game starts. Now imagine you hit the reset button and start up the game again, but this time the blocks are arranged in a different way, and Goombas and Koopas are showing up in weird locations. Hit the reset button again, and again a new arrangement of the same core pieces. Mario Galaxy is basically working under the philosophy of the galaxy resetting itself, remixing itself every time. Like Rosalina said, the cycle never repeats the same way. In fact, this idea explains Mario's multiple lives. How can Mario fall into a pit, die, but then have three more tries to get it right? It's new iterations of the galaxy each time. It's also an explanation for Mario and Bowser being mortal enemies 90% of the time and cart buddies the other 10%. Or the on-again, off-again appearance of the Koopa Kids. Or where Geno and Mallow went. Please let there be a galaxy iteration where they come back. That game was so good. Okay, but how does this all explain Peach being dead? Easy. Rosalina is Peach's daughter from a previous cycle of the galaxy. Peach had a child, raised her, then died. Devastated, Rosalina flew away only to return and check on her home every 100 years, or every new cycle of the galaxy. It just so happens that the particular cycle featured in this game is one in which she gets roped into the action. Does this seem too metaphysical or too deep? It shouldn't, because it's the core core belief of the game. Anyone who's played the game beyond the Mario missions and has gone through it with Luigi has seen the proof for themselves. With Mario, you have the Rescue Luigi missions, where your clumsy brother gets himself trapped and you need to save him. Great, nothing unusual there. But when you play the game with Luigi and get to those missions again, you expect to be saving Mario, only to find that, nope, you're still saving Luigi. It's awkward. The explanation given for this is, well, I guess there's enough people in the universe for one person to look like me. Except what's really going on here is that you're meeting a version of Luigi from a different cycle of the galaxy. If nothing else, this encounter shows that Super Mario Galaxy is a title that bends metaphysical rules. Okay, if Rosalina and Luigi 2 are from previous cycles of the galaxy, how are they so young? How can Rosalina look the same age as Peach if they're mother and daughter? And how can Rosalina revisit her home planet every 100 years or more if she's a normal human with a normal human lifespan? Huh, come on, it doesn't take an Einstein to figure that one out. Well, actually it does. Or at least it did. In 1905, Albert Einstein proposed a theory, a scientific theory, called special relativity. You know E equals MC squared? Energy equals mass times the speed of light squared? Yeah, that's a part of it. It's incredibly complicated stuff, but suffice it to say, it completely changed the course of physics, and answered a lot of scientists' lingering questions around time, space, and light. It also, believe it or not, answers how Rosalina and Peach can be practically the same age. One of the consequences of his theory was the concept of time dilation, or the fact that time slows with motion. The faster you move, the more difference occurs, and at speeds close to the speed of light, time practically stops. It sounds crazy, but it's been proven. Two synchronized atomic clocks were tested. One clock was kept on Earth, while another one was put into a high-speed plane and flown around for a while. When the plane returned, the clock was behind by exactly the amount Einstein's equations predicted. But when they resynchronized the clocks on Earth, they were still running at exactly the same rate. In other words, time had passed slower on the plane because of how fast it was traveling. Time had dilated or expanded. In other words, time travel is proven to be a real thing. Now look at Rosalina's ship. It travels between galaxies at speeds approaching the speed of light. So for her, time moves much slower relative to the time on Earth. In fact, using an online time dilation calculator, I was able to conclude that 1 year aboard her ship traveling slightly under the speed of light would actually be the equivalent of 100 years of Earth time. So say Rosalina is 20, that's 2,000 years worth of Earth time, and that's a conservative estimate. Einstein, truly you have given the world many great gifts, but none compare with your most recent contribution to society. Proof that fictional characters are related. But enough science, let's get back to the lore. Did you ever notice that Rosalina never refers to Peach by name? She always calls her Mario's special one, probably because she feels awkward calling her mom by her real name. Or maybe that was the pet name Mario would use for her when they were together. Sure, it's not quite as compelling of evidence as relativistic physics, but hey, it's something. Now, if you still don't believe me, man, you really have some serious trust issues, because I have proved this thing every way to Sunday. Lore, genetics, physics, I mean seriously, cut me some slack here. But I'm sure there are still some of you out there who are going to say, oh, you're overthinking the game, oh, the designers didn't plan this. Well, to disprove every last doubting Wario out there, Yoshiaki Koizumi, that's about as good as I'm going to get at pronouncing that name, the writer of Rosalina's storybook, said during an interview that Rosalina was originally intended to be related to Princess Peach. There, boom, done. Of course, he didn't say how, which prompted the internet to assume that they were sisters, but we now know better. And finally, since I'm not leaving any stone unturned here, there's one last huge piece of evidence hidden in the French version of the game. That's right, we're getting international up in here. Look at the epilogue of Rosalina's story in English. She dedicates her life to the Lumas, vows to revisit Earth every 100 years, and flies away. But the French version of the story has an extra little detail worked in. Everything is about the same, except for the second to last page. It has a little bit more text worked in. Let me brush off my French here as best I can. Retournez sur ma planète bleue, bleue, bleue. My French teacher's gonna watch this and be so embarrassed. Here we go. I'm gonna make this super sexy. J'aimerais bien, une fois tu les entends, retourner sur ma planète bleue et m'assoupir sur les genoux de ma papa et cassant cette moustache qui fait sa fierté. That was hot. French language love. So if you didn't spend 7 years learning the difference between a croque monsieur and a croque madame, you could probably figure out the following. My dad, something something, caressing his mustache. But luckily, I spent a couple years butchering the language, and coupling that with the power of Google Translate, it says the following, quote, I would like once every 100 years to return back to my blue planet and doze on the knees of my father stroking the mustache that was his pride. And what you have there, loyal theorists, cut from the English version, for some reason, is our last piece of incredibly strong evidence that Mario is Rosalina's father. I mean, I suppose by that logic, the father could also be Luigi, but that would be... No, it couldn't. Same attached ears, same blue eyes, and he's left-handed, meaning the odds of Peach and Luigi having a left-handed child like Rosalina would be double. Luigi is much taller than Mario, and Rosalina is a towering figure in the Mario universe. And back in the storybook, when Rosalina is describing playing with her brother, the brother is wearing a green hat. It's subtle, sure, but if you look close enough, it's definitely included there on purpose. Then there's the telescope that belonged to Rosalina's father that she takes on her intergalactic journey and appears on the last page of her storybook. Mario is never depicted with a telescope throughout the series, but we know for a fact Luigi has one. He inherited it as part of his mansion. And don't you find it a bit coincidental that when you beat Super Mario Galaxy with Luigi and all 120 stars, then collect the secret final star at the end, you're rewarded with a picture of Luigi and Rosalina? Father and daughter? You know, when it was referenced in the game that Rosalina and Peach were related, it was Miyamoto himself who pulled the plug on it, insisting the reference be removed. For years, we've been led to believe that Peach and Mario are gaming's it couple, but this whole cover-up would make perfect sense if Nintendo had known all along that Luigi is the one Peach ultimately ends up with. It would also explain Peach's utter lack of affection for Mario in every game ever. But if that were to get out, it would throw everything we've ever thought about this franchise into utter chaos. Nah, it couldn't be. Could it? But hey, that's just a theory. A game theory.